welcome to the world of cinematics. I'll be your host today. We have with us Jed.
Hello.
We have Brendan as well. And of course myself, Stefan, and Robert.
Can you see me in the shadow?
Our friendly disembodied voice.
Yeah,
our guy in the chair.
Yeah, that's Robert. Today we have a very interesting discussion. Today I'm very excited. We've prepared a lot of images and clips for you. And I can't wait to get into that. But first, before I give that little announcement of what we're getting into today, I wanted to do a little off the bat.
Go ahead.
Where's the bat?
It's stuck. Okay, round two. It worked.
Yay.
Man, you work so hard on something and it just doesn't work.
It's kind of like a firework that just starts sputtering.
It's funny you said it just doesn't work, Rob.
Huh?
Because we're talking about Weird, the new Weird Al biopic. And, unfortunately, it was excellent. I will say this. You know, do you remember that iRobot movie?
Yeah, with Will Smith.
Yeah, so it's a long story behind the making of that movie. That movie originally was something not iRobot at all, not something Isaac Asimov at all, but the studio got the rights to Isaac Asimov's works. And they said, hey, we've got this murder mystery robot thing we've been kicking around. Let's make it Isaac Asimov. But the iRobot thing, the most famous one, that's a collection of short stories.
Mm-hmm.
So they just put a few Isaac Asimov elements into the script, right? And hence, it's not even based on this. It's credited as suggested by iRobot. Weird Al is not based on the true life story of Weird Al Yankovic.
What? But
Yankovic.
He told me.
Yeah, it is suggested by the true life story of Weird Al Yankovic.
Hmm.
Okay, Brendan, what if I told you... Okay.
I have not seen it.
Yes, Brendan has not seen it. The rest of us have. So,
I'm not the one who missed out.
David Bowie's a really cool guy, right?
Sure.
Cool singer, great actor, interesting stage presence. What if I told you that we were going to make a movie about David Bowie, and in this, he was going to kill Saddam Hussein himself? And what if I told you that he was going to be killed in his moment of triumph that day that he finally colonized Pluto?
The look on your face says it all.
Does this happen in the weird movie?
No.
Oh, okay.
But it wouldn't really...
Things.
See, it's funny and crazy. It doesn't really work for David Bowie. Because he's funny and weird in a different way.
Yeah, it'd make more sense for Weird Al.
Because Weird Al, if you've seen UHF, you remember that scene where he's mowing down people as Rambo, and no one can hit him, and he never runs out of ammunition, even though he's just firing nonstop forever?
And there's literally no
bullets on
bullets.
Now imagine a movie like that, except it wasn't a daydream. The whole movie is that movie. And it's the life story of Weird Al Yankovic.
I gotta watch this.
Yes. It's different from any other movie I'd seen before. The closest frame of reference I have to it is Walk Hard: The Dewey Cox Story, also a parody of musical biopics. That one I think I like marginally better, but this one, it's totally unique. It's doing its own thing where it's a fantasy, it's completely made up, and it works whether or not you know the story of Weird Al or not. But especially if you do. If you love Weird Al, this is not just a movie about Weird Al, it is a Weird Al movie about Weird Al.
Okay.
It feels like the successor to UHF in a way.
Mm-hmm.
Just because it's Weird Al being weird and doing all these things and implying, oh, this is my life, this is what was happening to me at the time, and it's like, no, none of...
Yes.
For example, the trailer spoils that. He has a relationship and relations with Madonna. Never happened, ever.
Mm-hmm.
But it's part of the joke, is that this whole thing is a joke.
Yes.
Like, it goes against the grain of who Weird Al really is. It's basically making fun of this is a rock documentary of a rock star and how they drink and do drugs and all this stuff.
It's what he does with music. He takes the same music and then makes it funnier with his own lyrics. He's taking this genre of rock band origin story or whatever, and making it funnier.
To spoil one of the very funny moments, but one that's less meta.
Mm.
So at one point, he's sick and tired of only being known as a parody artist. He wants to make songs of his own, which Weird Al has made many songs of his own, and they're all excellent. and the first song he made of his own that isn't a parody at all, Eat It. But then, just a day later, Michael Jackson releases his own parody song called Beat It.
He's like, what, was this about AIDS or something?
That kid from the Jackson 5? He's a nobody.
He's like, actually, he's very popular. No, he's parodying my work. This is my work. Original content.
How dare somebody put words to my song?
Change the words to my song. Who does that in the guy? Used to be you.
Yeah, that's one beat from the movie. Sorry to spoil it, but that's the kind of tone you're getting with this movie.
And Daniel Radcliffe knocks it out of the park.
Yes, he's excellent.
So funny.
Mm-hmm.
He's unrecognizable in this role.
He's not Harry Potter.
Yeah, he's definitely not Harry Potter.
He does what Weird Al does, where when he's being funny, he's funny. And when he's being dramatic, he gives it all, which makes it funny.
Yeah.
All right, sweet.
Did
Sounds
you know
good.
this, in the making of this, I found out last night, it's based on a Funny or Die clip.
Yep.
Where they made a fake trailer for the Weird Al movie way back in 2010.
Mm-hmm. And it is a Funny or Die production.
And it has the same director that they said was going to do this fake movie. And mm-hmm. had Aaron Paul as Weird Al. And it was so funny. And he just like sitting there smoking. And he's like, I'm going to write words. I'm going to change the lyrics to a song.
Oh, I guess I would have gotten him to do it.
But apparently he
might be a bit too old at this point.
He was going to cameo. But then he got COVID. So it was off the bat.
Yeah, they didn't have time to push back the shooting because they shot this film in 12 days, I think it was.
Like 2 weeks.
Yeah, they were going to get Sam Rockwell to be his mentor in the rock business. But he like broke his foot the day before shooting. And so like, quick, who can we grab to do this? They got Rainn Wilson and he was just memorizing his scripts overnight. And like, he'd have this script and throw it to the side when they said action. That's how pushed together this was.
Holy cow.
And it worked. It was perfection.
Those who don't know, that's the guy who plays Dwight.
Yes.
Oh, that's cool.
Mm-hmm.
Overall, when we were all saying, oh yeah, it's funny, my reaction was, it's stupid. It's a stupid comedy, but it's in a good way.
Yes.
But it is stupid, so.
Sweet. Like Nacho Libre stupid?
No.
More, it's like Hot Rod stupid in a way.
Yes.
Because there's lots of violence for no apparent reason.
I think it's done much better than Hot Rod.
Yeah,
I'm not the best Hot Rod guy, but it is in that vein of comedy. It's very Lonely Island.
Yeah, yeah.
So it's like a quality of like Rocket Man. It's like really good.
Yeah. There's no violence. Well, actually, there is the monkey bites him.
There is some pretty extreme violence in this. Comical, it's cartoonish, but
UHF stuff.
Yes, it's to the point where like most anyone could watch this, but if you got like a 4 or 5 year old, maybe wait 2 or 3 years.
Oh, okay.
Because they won't understand that it's a lot of this stuff that a kid might think is scary is funny to an adult.
Yes.
So yeah. Overall, I think we all enjoyed the film.
Yes. So, if you want to go watch it, it's free. Just go to the Roku channel. There are ads in it, but, you know, there was like, what, 3-4 ad breaks in the whole movie? It's an hour, 45 minutes.
Not that many. It's not a very long movie.
And there's there's an original Weird Al song in the chorus, and I loved it.
Yeah, at the very end of
And it's eligible for Oscars.
He mentions it.
Mm-hmm.
And he talks about how long credits are usually.
Mm.
Great song.
Yeah.
Cool.
Perfect. So shall we transition to the main topic today, Jeff?
Let's do it.
We've been waiting for this one, but that means Stefan.
This is a topic that's very important to me, so that's why I'm leaning forward.
Why he's the host.
Yes, this is me showing that I care. So.
ED Awareness Month right now.
Yes, I wanted to make an announcement. No, this is DD awareness. This is we're talking about Daredevil. Yeah,
that's
today.
Right.
Yeah,
DD.
Where E and D, they have the same reason.
Yeah,
they sound the same.
So today I wanted to talk. Well, all of us wanted to talk on the differences between Daredevil Netflix versus Daredevil Disney, and I wanted to start the discussion basically by getting everyone's take on first the character and sort of the Netflix show. You know, how were you introduced to the character? What were your first impressions of the character? and then your first impressions of the show. And I wanted to start off for myself. Mm-hmm. For myself, the first time I was introduced to the character of Daredevil was it was a DVD. I was going to say it was a VHS. Mm-hmm. It was a DVD. It was from the Spider-Man show from, I think, the 90s. It was Spider-Man versus Daredevil.
Mm-hmm.
And just the poster there was very striking. It had Spider-Man's head and just Daredevil with a very gritty Frank Miller-looking face.
Mm-hmm.
And we watched it, and obviously it wasn't as gritty as Frank Miller. But just the swashbuckling nature, the street-level hero who's on par with Spider-Man. Spider-Man respects him. He's blind. He's a lawyer.
Mm-hmm.
All those sort of things. And just the way he said, Daredevil, I was like, wow, this is very striking. And then I was tempted to watch the 2003 show. Didn't look very good. But then the Netflix show came out, and I remember the first teaser. I thought, this is going to be a great show. This is going to be really good. Like, chef's kiss. And then they released a couple more trailers. I saw clips of fight scenes. Oh, I was like, this is like if you took the best aspects, the serious aspects from Sam Raimi's Spider-Man trilogy, and then mutated them and put them on steroids and focused and honed in on those character moments, on great action, great cinematography, and took away basically all of the hamminess.
Yeah.
And it allowed itself to be as good as The Dark Knight, and as serious, but in a lot of ways, but also to have humanity, to have things to look forward to. So that was my initial introduction to the character of Daredevil and also to the show. So who'd like to go next?
I can go. Yeah, basically, I remember that cartoon now that you bring it up, but the first time I thought Daredevil was cool was when I saw the clip. The hallway fight scene in season one. Mm-hmm. I saw that on YouTube. I kept on watching it over and over. And I showed my friends at school. I had one friend. And then we watched it over and over again. It was just so, so freaking cool. It's like, oh yeah, now we're going to go train to be martial artists. It's one of those things that make you want to do something with your life.
Mm-hmm.
It's really, really cool. Kind of like how Avatar Last Airbender sort of thing. You see cool things, you want to be able to do cool things. So, and it's very grounded, you know, even more so than other things, because he doesn't have any real powers that are blatantly obvious if you don't know that he's blind.
Mm-hmm.
So, I just love that to death. So, yeah, Daredevil was really cool from that moment on. Well, almost. Not.
Yeah, we'll touch on that. For me... My introduction to Daredevil was probably in 2003. I didn't see the movie, but, you know, I remember playing on the playground at school. I imagine one of these kids had seen Daredevil recently, because he said, yeah, I want to be Daredevil. I went, well, who's Daredevil?
Who's that?
You know, I like Spider-Man, I like Batman, I don't know who Daredevil is. And he says, oh, he's a superhero that's blind, and he wears red, and he has, like, these little horns on his costume. He's so cool. I'm like, okay, it's kind of weird that he's blind. Mm. What can he do?
Mm.
Like, he beats people up, so he doesn't have any powers? Well, no, he's blind. And so I'm like, oh, Daredevil's lame. And so didn't really think of him much from that point on. I later came to know that there was a Daredevil movie, and it was lame, so had no interest in Daredevil. But then, hey, Marvel has given Netflix rights to make some shows on their characters. It's going to kind of be in the MCU, and they're going to do what Marvel won't. I'm like, okay, that sounds interesting. I don't know if it'll be good. And I knew, you know, probably with the, they'll do things Marvel can't, probably wouldn't be allowed to watch it. I grew up in a bit of a sheltered home. But it came out, and everyone said, guys, this is actually really good.
Mm-hmm.
And at that point in my life, I had graduated a semester early, and so when I wasn't at work, no one else was at home. So I'm like, you know what, I'll give this a shot. And I watched the first episode, I'm like, that was amazing. I'm not watching the rest for a little while, because that was, you know, growing up in this very sheltered environment, that was the very first, you know, extremely violent, but also extremely dark, mature adult thing that I had been exposed to.
Mm.
Like, previously, the darkest thing I'd seen maybe was The Dark Knight, which granted has its moments of, you know, intensity, but it's not like, okay, let's have a scene where we watch a prison guard slowly suffocate a woman in prison trying to kill her, and you really hold on her being beaten and her being not being able to breathe and screaming for help and scratching his eyes out. It's very graphic. And so I'm like, oh my gosh. And before I left on my mission, I had made it through the next two episodes. I'll always remember that because episode three ends with a very graphic moment of a face-eye injury. And I'm just like, okay, I'm going to need to wait a little while. Mm. Serving my mission, one of my companions, we're just talking one day, and he's like, okay, what's the biggest regret you had? Like, you know, if you, you know, something you wish you could have seen or watched or done, because we were talking, he hadn't seen the latest Hobbit movie. He wished he could have seen that. And I said, Daredevil, I wish I could have finished that series. When I get home, it's going to be one of the first things I do. Mm. And I did. And I loved it. Mm-hmm. And so from then on, it's like, oh yeah, give me Defenders, give me, you know, more, give me Punisher. And, you know, it was all
good.
Yeah, it was all from there.
Good from there on out.
Mm-hmm. Now, Robert, on the other hand,
just watched it recently.
He just finished it last mm-hmm. weekend.
Maybe 2 weeks.
It was 2 weeks
ago.
Two weeks ago. Yeah.
I don't remember when my first time hearing about Daredevil.
That's okay.
Yep. End of story.
But we've told you much about how amazing this show is. So
yeah.
Very high expectations when you went into it. How did it live up to it?
It lived past it, I feel like, because watching it as of like getting into more of an understanding how movies should be done, like how the like, difference between an A-plus show and the F-minus show,
mm-hmm.
we'll get to that.
Mm-hmm.
Watching this show, I'm just like, wow, this really is peak for me. Because even the second season, I understand what you guys meant.
Yeah, the second season, the weakest season.
Still
very good.
Like, I will rewatch that over Vision and Wanda.
Mm-hmm.
And I actually didn't like Vision and Wanda, but...
WandaVision?
Wanda, whatever. Vision's cool. but I prefer Daredevil after watching that show.
Yeah.
Like, his story, we'll get more into it, but...
Mm-hmm.
Anyway.
When you compare the two, one of them has a whole MCU backing it, and I'm assuming WandaVision has a higher budget, at least visual effects definitely was higher.
Certainly, and season, on a season versus season basis.
Right, mm-hmm. Season versus season, not all three seasons. Oh, maybe even then, the three Daredevil seasons were cheaper
true.
Than the one season of WandaVision.
Possibly.
But yeah, I could be totally wrong. Don't at me.
Or do at us, and then we'll not
we'll,
listen.
We'll apologize.
Yeah, so we'll do a full apology video.
On our knees.
I'm sorry.
I'm sorry that you're wrong.
But back to the point, you know, it doesn't matter that you get a higher budget and this like whole end game just barely happened and you got all that hype and it doesn't matter. This Daredevil is a better story
mm-hmm.
than WandaVision or Winter Soldier, Falcon and Winter Soldier, and all those shows, Loki.
They all pale in comparison.
They do. They really do. And I enjoyed Moon Knight a little bit, and Loki was okay. But Daredevil just beats them out of the water.
Mm-hmm.
It's arguably, at least for me, as good a show, if not better, than Batman the Animated Series. And I think, honestly, I think it is better.
Mm.
But, you know, those are the two great superhero shows, if you're going to reference great superhero shows.
Yeah.
And Daredevil, I think, knocked it out of the park.
Yeah. Well,
So I was just wondering how we all felt when it was announced that it was canceled. And that might not include Robert, because he's got hindsight.
He watched it after it was canceled.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
And he
I remember your guys' reaction when you heard it canceled. I remember you guys being really upset.
I mean, for myself, I would say I agree. I was upset, but I was like, you know, at least they ended on a high note.
Right.
At least it was like they had resolved enough that I was like, yeah, it feels like a trilogy rather than just a show. It's like, yeah.
Really, there was only one loose end, and it was the last scene
of the
whole show. Yeah, the
very last scene. But other than that, it's like, you have your beginning, you had your middle, and then you had your end, and we resolved a lot of things. We resolved the dynamic between him and Kingpin.
Mm-hmm.
I was like, well, at least it can rest in peace. If it came back, I would not object to that.
Yeah.
And that was essentially my reaction. What was your reaction, Ben?
To the cancelization?
Yeah.
Oh.
Cancelization.
What do I call it? Cancelization?
Yeah, cancelization. I don't know. I'm going to say cancelization.
I like that. So the cancelization of Daredevil is pretty messed up. It was better than...
it's pretty messed up, man.
I'm going to compare it. It wasn't that bad like Stefan was saying. It was pretty wrapped up and happy ending.
Mm-hmm.
It one cancelization that I think is a good example of a bad place to end was when Disney bought Star Wars and they canceled Clone Wars.
Mm-hmm.
And it's just like right after Ahsoka left the Jedi Order and you're just like...
Yeah,
such a cliffhanger.
And even when they said, hey, we have... a little more to that we'll throw on Netflix.
Yeah.
Even then, that didn't really wrap up a lot of loose threads.
It wrapped up the Order 66, but it didn't. Mm-hmm. It didn't wrap up the whole story. Yes.
Yeah.
It didn't feel like Clone Wars was over, and that's why they finished it. And they finished it well, luckily.
Mm-hmm.
So if they were to go back and finish Daredevil, I'd be okay with that too. But at the same time, I think they wrapped it up well enough that I don't really need it, and I don't
mm-hmm.
really trust them anyway. So let's just leave it how it is. Make your reboot, Disney. Go ahead.
Yeah.
Netflix is famous for canceling shows very judiciously. All they care about is, will this next thing we produce, will it bring in more new subscribers than it will cost? And so, one season of Daredevil, people are like, oh my gosh, everyone needs to see this. The second season, guys, if you haven't watched the first season, go watch it. And by the third season... their rationale was everyone who is going to sign up for Daredevil has already signed up. So we don't need to make any more. It's done. It'll just be wasting money at that point. Because everyone who wants to watch Daredevil is already here, and they can just keep watching these three seasons from now to the end of time. And I don't like that rationale, but I get it from a business perspective. So when I saw it, I was like, dang it. Well, at least... we'll be able to see Daredevil pop up in, like, Jessica Jones, or maybe there'll be a Defenders season 2, stuff like that. But then not too long afterwards, there was like, yep, nope, final season for this show, final season for this show, that show's been canceled, final season, we're like, oh gosh, this really is the end.
Yeah.
And like you guys said, I want more, but at least it's a high point in terms of quality, and at least we got resolution.
Yeah, agreed. Any other thoughts, Robert? You don't have to, but...
Yeah, no.
No,
don't have
okay. So, moving right along to the renewal, which came, what was that, 2 or 3 years late? 3 years later, I think it was.
Yeah, final season was 2018,
and
it was
2021,
renewed. Yeah.
So, they announced, basically, that they had the character back, and they brought him into Spider-Man, and they brought Kingpin into Hawkeye.
Mm-hmm.
What were our initial, I'll start with myself, initial thoughts on those things. But, I was happy that he was back, and I certainly loved the cameo. That it was fan service in the sense that it was like, oh, it's reaching out to a specific group of the fans.
Mm-hmm.
So specific that when Charlie Cox actually saw it in theaters, the theaters were dead silent because nobody had any idea who it was.
Mm-hmm.
Which is, I think
it's very dependent on the theater you're in.
Right, but a lot of theaters...
it's like including the biggest.
My theater cheered like no other.
The two theaters that I went to, they cheered because they knew who he was, and I had to explain to my parents who he was. But that was great. The Kingpin stuff, not so great.
Well, I'll give it this. Remember at the very end of the second to last episode when it's revealed Kingpin is here? You got that needle drop of he's the mean one, Mr. Grinch, I was like, oh my gosh, it's Kingpin. Because that was before Spider-Man came out. So everyone's like,
two thumbs up.
We're getting him back. This is it.
Right.
And then it wasn't.
No.
Well, we had that discussion too of like, they could have.
Yeah, go back and watch the episode.
Because, I don't think we talked about it on the show.
We did briefly.
We did?
Yeah, we talked about like, our thoughts on Hawkeye, the finale. What do you think of Kingpin?
Oh,
he's like,
way back then.
I was talking about recently when we were after I watched the Netflix version. I was like, what they should have done for Kingpin is not even have him in the Hawkeye show at all.
Mm.
Had just that cameo.
Decent.
Yeah, that cameo would
have
been good.
He will be
like,
coming.
He is the big boss. You're not gonna see him yet. That would have been a better approach, in my opinion.
Mm-hmm.
Right, rather than a climactic fight with. Suit like half CGI explosions and him getting shot
by a freaking car and
right
surviving.
And all these things, and it's like
they did
so he's different, right?
Yeah, they did enough of that to justify, okay, this is his own thing. We love Vincent D'Onofrio as Kingpin, but Kingpin from the Netflix show can't survive being hit by a car and then being exploded by all this all these tiny grenades, and he's not superhuman. And so when they established that, I was like, okay, this was his own continuity. There's probably going to be similar things, but it's not the same. Okay, I can live with this.
Yeah.
I could live with it if they would at least give the same level of depth to the writing and the same level of nuance in the portrayal. Because that's what made me fall in love with the character in the first place. But they didn't. And so when they had just Kingpin as a one-dimensional caricature instead of this surprisingly deep and emotional character that he is in the show, mm-hmm. because he's pure evil in the show.
Yes.
But he's not just, oh, look at me, I'm a villain. They're, like, he has a really healthy relationship with the woman he loves. He wants to protect his city and make it better. He's just going about it in a wrong way. So it's a great example of, it's almost as if the creators of Hawkeye didn't understand the nature of the character of Kingpin.
Right.
Which
I think that is translated to other elements as well.
Well, on that note about his relationship with Vanessa, like, props again to the Netflix show. At the very end, you start to feel like, I really hope everything's working out for them. You're like, wait, you guys, you're playing with this. Why? They're both evil.
There's a scene with Kingpin and Vanessa. There's a scene at the beginning
relationship.
Of the for season 3 where he says, I'm afraid that me being in love with you is just because I'm looking at a reflection of myself. I feel like I'm cheating myself.
Yeah.
And that, you know, I don't deserve you, basically.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And she says, that's the point of finding, you know, because he said, I'm broken. She's like, that's the point of finding everybody's broken. And the point is finding people whose broken pieces fit with yours.
Like a puzzle.
And it's like, oh my gosh, that's so heartwarming. I hope you guys have a nice... Wait a second, you're a murderer.
Yeah, like...
You scum?
When she finally gets back, like, she seems so distant from him, and the relationship seems like it's struggling, and all of a sudden you're, like, in this romance thing. You're like, but they're made for each other.
Right.
Why do I care?
And it's well done. It's very well done.
Yeah.
So good. But it built his character of how Vanessa is his other half.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And she's crucial to him as a character.
Well, and I was always interested in was what season 4 might be, and I always thought Vanessa was the clear villain because Daredevil had nothing on her.
Well, Kingpin's he has something to use against her, but if he uses that, he loses his leverage against Kingpin.
Exactly.
So she's kind of untouchable in a sense.
Yes, and then she would probably recruit Bullseye, because technically she's got no beef with them.
Yeah.
I mean, unless. You know, if she's
smart
about it.
Not exactly the most stable person, but...
Yeah. If she's smart about it, I bet she could convince him.
She could easily become his North Star if she worked hard enough for it.
Yeah, just pretend to be his new lover and then portray him in the end again. And he's kind of a sucker, I think.
They said they were planning on using Typhoid Mary. I don't know much about the character of Typhoid Mary in the comics. From what I understand,
she's
one of the more famous Daredevil villains, but that's not really saying much.
No, the
he's known for his rogues.
Name five Daredevil villains right there.
So there's Stiltman, Elektra, Bullseye, Kingpin, and
who's still
the
Owl. The general?
It's a man literally on stilts.
Yeah.
And
this guy, jumping in. And
the Owl. So I can name five, but it doesn't mean that they're all great.
Yeah.
So
some of them are some of the best ever, and most of them aren't.
I mean, if I said, like,
Nobu, that's a good one.
We're going off on a tangent.
Mm-hmm.
So, just to reel it back, I think essentially, if they didn't have him fight Kate Bishop at the end, I would have been fine with the portrayal, because it's limited, and it hints at things to come.
Yeah, they should have done what Robert was saying, just kind of like, maybe an after-credit scene.
Mm.
Just have him show up, and have his goons walk up to him, maybe, what's her butt? The girl that shot him in the Echo walk up to him and say she failed or whatever.
Mm-hmm.
I don't remember the plot. Maybe she turned on him by then. I don't know. I don't care. And so she walks up to him. She says, oh, I failed. And then he just beats the crap out of him. And we just see how dangerous and scary this guy is.
Because he does not
want
bad news.
Or even you could have the clip where it says, this city belongs to me. And then you don't have the fight. And then you end with him just coming out of his car. His guards getting taken out, and she points a gun at him, and he can still have that dialogue with client or family. And then the ambiguous ending.
Right.
But they didn't do that, and it started to look cartoonish.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
So I don't prefer that over grounded stuff.
Yeah.
Which is kind of what the MCU has been doing with these characters.
Yeah.
Becoming more cartoony, less serious.
Mm-hmm.
And you can feel that, and it's not fun.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so then flash forward a few months later, a few months back from now, we're watching the trailer for She-Hulk right after we watched the trailer for Black Panther.
Yep.
And She-Hulk is just like, yeah, this isn't really making us laugh. We're not all really that interested, but yeah.
Right, we're kind of like, eh, whatever.
Don't plan on watching it. But then who jumps in at the very end? It's Daredevil in his yellow and red costume.
And you could hardly tell in the first trailer.
Dumb costume.
But then as we started getting more images and stills and whatever else,
mm-hmm.
it's like, oh, they're going Daredevil yellow.
Which,
okay.
Yeah, many people had said beforehand, hey, if this show is going to be full of cameos, like they're saying, introduce Daredevil. We've already seen Matt Murdock, but they're the two lawyer superheroes of Marvel. They're good foils for each other. Please do it.
Right.
And then we see that, we're like, this can be interesting. This could be good.
Yeah.
Right. He could bring a level of seriousness. And this is something that
a little credibility to it.
That I hate is when you say, oh, well, her show is not serious. Therefore, he must not be serious. And he can be goofy and stupid.
Mm.
And it's like,
no. The Batman-Superman argument right there.
Yeah, exactly. And that's where I'm going. And I can't remember who made this argument. But they made the argument. When Batman crosses over with the Ninja Turtles, or with Superman, or Scooby-Doo, or anybody, does he stop being Batman for the sake of those people? Or
no.
Does the contrast pay off because we see the
mm-hmm.
difference in character?
I mean...
And it's the latter of the two.
That
titles.
Works for shows like Teen Titans Go, where everyone's goofy.
Where everyone's stupid.
But that just tells you what type of show She-Hulk is.
Yeah.
It's not MCU material.
Like,
it doesn't even take itself seriously.
It can work well in, say, like, the first Avengers movie. The stuff with Thor is very theatrical, very Shakespearean.
Mm.
Captain America, he's still that solid, good old American boy. Like, there's only one God, man. Pretty sure he doesn't dress like that. Tony Stark is still Tony Stark. And when they're in close proximity interacting with each other, it brings out their those qualities that make them unique even stronger in each other. So
right.
I still had hope that we could see something similar in She-Hulk.
No. And
we didn't.
And exactly.
We didn't.
Then the reason I'm so passionate about this, and we're all passionate, we love this show, we love the character, and the thing is, when Tony Stark and, sadly enough, Chadwick Boseman as T'Challa is gone, and we're
mm-hmm.
not going to get T'Challa back for at least another 20 years, I'd say,
mm-hmm.
and Steve Rogers, the three people that I liked the most, and Thor is now a buffoon.
Oh, Spider-Man.
And, yeah, I like Spider-Man.
Like, Spider-Man's, doing his own thing right now. We don't know when we'll see him again.
Right. He has a totally different story now.
Yeah, MCU's kind of...
It's all over
the
place.
It's in a questionable
phase. It's fractured into its own separate little storylines.
I needed somebody that I could relate with and root for
mm-hmm.
who could bring the MCU into the future.
Yeah, well...
Because we lost all those good characters.
The show wasn't made for you, Mike. It's made for women.
I know that. I'm very well aware of that. Yeah.
It's made for me.
Yeah.
That's essentially our reaction to the show, because it's like...
Well, like, so much of the show we didn't like, but we had written off as, okay, whatever, I'll just tune in again when Daredevil shows up.
Yeah, we got...
Because at least Daredevil will be great.
Right, and then we got this. Go
we
ahead
got
and pull
this Daredevil
this
right
image.
Here.
Now, this is an image that you'll see a lot of people saying, oh, well, he did something stupid in the comics, therefore if he does anything stupid in the show, look at this image. He's an idiot.
They're justifying it in that this is taken straight from the source material. It is being faithful, therefore it is good.
Here's another image of being faithful with Batman and Robin.
Why haven't they done this yet?
Yeah. So we have, essentially, Bruce Wayne and Dick Grayson in bed.
Mm-hmm.
Apparently, I have no idea why. But they had a slumber party,
mm-hmm.
which is the nicest way of saying it. And it's like, just because something was stupid in the comics doesn't mean you have to adapt it, and that's not a defense. There's plenty of crappy material in the comics.
And there's Dark Knight Returns Part 2. And that's...
Oh, gosh.
That's bad. You don't adapt that just because the first part was good.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, so,
yeah.
I mean, in fairness, you can take bad material and make it good. Like, Spider-Man No Way Home is a pretty close adaptation of the One More Day storyline from Spider-Man.
Which people don't.
Like, destroyed Spider-Man comic sales. Everyone hated it. It ruined the character so much. But they said, there's something key in here. The deal with the devil, that same what am I willing to give up for my own convenience, having it backfire, and I learn responsibility.
Yeah.
And they took that scene and made a great story out of it.
Yeah, and when you can take a good story, like a lot of people like Dark Knight Returns, and make it into a movie like Batman vs. Superman.
Which,
I like that movie, but a lot of people hate it. And they may love the comic book.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so it can go both ways.
Yeah.
This She-Hulk show just, I don't know what they're basing it off. I'm not a She-Hulk fan.
Mm-hmm.
But it just sucked. It was just bad. So, I mean.
So, but for the most part, it was bad and harmless.
Well, sure, you got the Tobey Maguire clip. Trash rock.
It was bad in a way that I could ignore it.
It's inconsequential. And that's one of the reasons I hated the inclusion of Daredevil.
Mm-hmm.
What is his impact to Spider-Man? It's a pretty big deal what he does for Spider-Man. And
mm-hmm.
his inclusion is important. They fight Leapfrog. And then they get together.
Hey, rip it and rip it, man.
Oh, my God.
That was so dumb.
So,
why do I have to watch that?
I'm sorry.
And speaking of bad or iffy material,
mm-hmm.
They could justify that, and I found a justification for the yellow and red suit.
Mm-hmm.
What are Iron Man's colors?
Yeah, yellow and red.
So when she says, what are you, ketchup and mustard? We could have had a serious moment where he says, actually, I'm wearing this in order to honor Iron Man.
Yeah, this is a living memorial
for this
higher standard.
He saved the universe, which
mm-hmm.
is more than you'll ever do.
Yeah.
And it's like, yeah, and that'd be a powerful moment. And she could be like, finally sober
like,
for once.
Yeah, a little bit of
and
self-reflection.
Say, sorry about that.
No, she probably would have looked at the camera and said, see this man, man's
oh, my word,
me.
Yeah, probably. It's just, they made, we're not talking about her.
Yeah.
Because she's insufferable. And I'll go on too long if I do.
Yeah.
But
this isn't to say that, you know, Daredevil itself, himself, doesn't have somewhat of a funnier side. In the MCU, when he catches the brick, how'd you do that? I'm a pretty good lawyer.
I'm a really good lawyer.
Or,
yeah. That's fun.
Or we have another moment pulled up from the original show to show he does have a more lighthearted side. There is a way to have a funnier, more character-based comedy with him.
See, that's what you get for taking Punjabi instead of Spanish with me. Just to chase a girl.
What?
No. Sorry.
I'll have you know that Punjabi is the future language of the future of business. A couple years, we'll all be speaking it. And she was so hot. She was so hot.
Yeah, say that in Punjabi.
God, shut up.
Was that longer than 30 seconds?
No, it was like 26.
Oh,
so
okay.
We're just pushing it.
Yeah, he's ribbing his friend, but in a way that shows, hey, I like you, I care about you, but I'm also here to, you know, to deflate you a little when you're getting a little too puffed up. It's funny. It's compassionate.
Yeah.
It's like that clip, you could say, like, are those two brothers? They don't look anything like each other, but they have such a strong bond.
Yeah, and it's character comedy. It's
mm-hmm.
not, oh, let's wink at the camera. It's not laugh track sitcom comedy or meta comedy or whatever. It's very, we are having a moment
mm-hmm.
and we're making fun of each other,
like
laughing, we're joking.
The original Star Wars, so many of the funny moments from that movie, like Han Solo, he's a guy who, just by watching one joke, you know, oh, he's a guy who thinks he's really cool, thinks he's greater than he is, but is just flying by the seat of his pants, making it all up. Oh, it's just a weapons malfunction, we're fine down here, we're fine.
How are you?
Who are you? And just instantly wincing, like, oh, that, I pushed too far on that.
Yeah.
Han Solo's
and here, you are seeing so much, you are learning as you're laughing about who Foggy is and who Matt Murdock is.
And you are also strengthening their relationship
mm-hmm.
through humor.
Yeah.
And it's juxtaposed at this time.
Yeah, because at this
episode,
point, in
they're having
that's
a
flashback
a
in the present.
Out. Yeah.
Not on great terms.
No, so it's,
and it makes it hurt so much more.
It does.
It works
it
dramatically,
does. Yeah.
It works comedically, it works in terms of just, you know, their relationship. Wonderful.
And another thing that was just off, and it's not the biggest deal. I don't think anyone has the biggest deal with this,
mm-hmm.
is just the action was off, like CGI Daredevil specifically.
Yeah. We'll go to this in just a second if you want to get that ready. We'll preface this by saying a lot of the CGI in Marvel stuff lately has been a little on the shoddy side. So this isn't the biggest deal, but it is indicative of a larger problem.
Boing.
Yeah, it's
boing,
boing,
boing.
Somebody called
no weight to it. He's
Rubber Man,
mm-hmm.
Rubber Band Man,
or Gumby Man, or something.
It's like
you
I want
to.
something that somebody pointed out to me once. The Star Wars prequels have some great choreography in their fights. If you're looking for, like, look how cool this is, look how skilled they are.
Yeah, sure.
And the Star Wars sequel trilogy failed on that side.
Mm.
The Star Wars sequel trilogy has great choreography in their fights. If you're looking for, like, what does this tell us about their character? What is this telling us about their mental state? You are able to tell a story and all that
sure.
with a fight. And the prequels maybe didn't do as great with that. Like, when Qui-Gon is killed and Obi-Wan's, he's real pissed. He's going to get back in there, and then he fights exactly the same way he did before. With what we just saw there, there wasn't exactly a whole lot of, like, look at the skill, look at how cool that is. And it didn't tell us much about his character ever. Now, granted, that was a 6-second clip. But let's contrast that with something from the Netflix show
yeah.
that excels at both the character-based choreography and just the overall awesomeness of it. Robert,
beautiful.
After watching that scene, what did you take? What does that tell you about Daredevil? What does that tell you about Kingpin? What does that tell you about Vanessa?
It tells you a lot. So, one, you're already seeing, like, throughout the series of how he has this inner battle with himself because he doesn't want to kill. It's against his values.
But he does want to kill.
But in this case,
it's tempting.
He
yeah.
is so close to snapping and just wanting to kill Kingpin
mm.
because of how much trouble he has put Daredevil through. How many people he's hurt.
Mm-hmm.
And you
it's
can see right
his there. Lower desires against his higher desires.
You can see right there, he's about to break his neck.
Mm-hmm.
And then he's just, he screams. He's just like, I can't, I gotta be better than this.
Mm-hmm.
And then Vanessa, like, you see the relationship between Vanessa and Kingpin there,
mm-hmm.
where she doesn't want to see him get hurt.
Mm-hmm.
Like, that, back to what we talked about earlier, it's like, why do I care about their relationship? But you kind of do. I mean, that's,
yeah.
that's the beautiful thing about it is, and you see the relationship between all of them right there. It's like, this is their enemy. But they're not going to, he's not going to overstep that line.
Mm-hmm.
Right. He's still conducting himself as a Christian in his darkest or most desperate moments. He still has the idea that God is there and I'm accountable to him. Even if something is super tempting, like, especially when he makes it tempting because...
Mm-hmm.
Fisk isn't just a thorn in his side, he's a spear in his side.
Right.
He's ruining his life, he's killed people he's loved.
Mm-hmm.
But even at the end of the day, the compassion and mercy of Christ
mm-hmm.
balances out the justice.
Like, this would no longer be self-defense. This is, I have him at my mercy. If I kill him, I am damning myself to hell. Because
right.
Catholicism is such a huge part of who this person is.
Mm-hmm.
Without Catholicism, played into his character, he is no longer Daredevil. He is no longer Matt Murdock. It is the source of so much of his pain and what drives him forward.
It's like what you said, removing Catholicism from Matt Murdock is like removing responsibility from Spider-Man.
Mm.
And that's something that I know why I didn't like Far From Home that much is because responsibility is removed in a lot of ways until the end of the film when he finally is 100% responsible for what he's done.
Mm-hmm.
And that actually did transition well to the sequel where it's like there's consequences for you not being responsible.
Yeah.
And there should be consequences for him not being a guilt-ridden Catholic. So I wanted to transition into the elephant in the room. The relationship between Matt Murdock and She-Hulk. And I wanted to discuss a big thing that people brought up to me when I was in the comment section of YouTube, that he slept with Elektra. Because my big issue is that he has a relationship and a one-night stand with She-Hulk in the show. And I'm going to explain why that doesn't work for me and why that doesn't work as a whole. And to preface this, it's important that we don't say that this is just, oh, it's Mark Waid's Daredevil, or Jeff Loeb's Daredevil, or Frank Miller's Daredevil. This is a direct adaptation of the Netflix Daredevil. Whether or not they consider that canon, It is irrelevant. We are going to compare it to it because it is an adaptation of that specific
They're using these actors because they want us to associate them with this story,
yep.
This adaptation.
Fair enough.
And so I wanted to first pull up a clip because that was kind of the elephant in the room. And it was that people were on comment section were saying, oh, well, he slept with Elektra. And I'm like, he sure did in the comics as well. I've read
mm-hmm.
Daredevil, Man Without Fear. He slept with Elektra.
Mm-hmm.
It's something he did in college.
Yeah.
And it's the same thing with the show. 10 years before the show, so that would be like 2005, he has a relationship with Elektra. But even then, his morals haven't completely abandoned him.
Mm-hmm.
I'm trying to remember. Is this... No, this one was this one for the religion or for romance? No,
this is for religion.
Oh.
Or no, it was romance.
It's both. Right.
Yeah,
This
is about how his sex life, his romantic side of his life, and his religion inform each other.
Right, yeah. This is kind of the meeting in the middle.
For those of you who haven't seen the show, this is a point where Matt is in his past. He is... fallen for this person who maybe isn't the greatest influence on him, but he is a good influence on her. And together they are growing and becoming, overall, I would say they are becoming better people. Just he had to go down first and she is bringing him up. He's bringing her up, but she is trying to pull him down.
He had to touch the darkness.
To know the light. That's really
dramatic. Bring you the power. That was so beautiful.
But even in the depths of his, like, his most depraved, his most, like, oh, I'm, no worries, Hakuna Matata. No inhibitions. Yeah.
So, just a little background. They broke into a house and they have this discussion, and I'll go ahead and let the clip speak for itself and we'll give our interpretation.
When you cross your face, and we get married.
Wow.
And we buy a house. I mean, houses, sorry. This is how we live.
And what about the kids? What are we going to do with them?
Oh, sweet little Ellie and a simpleton brother, Matty Jr. Can cook and clean and stock the fridge for us so we can use our time doing better things.
Like sex.
Exactly like sex.
That's kind of terrifying to have her using
a knife. Right on film.
She knows how to use knives.
Oh, that's the problem.
So the conversation there is let's have some more sex and all this. It's let's think about the future.
Mm-hmm.
Let's think about being married. That doesn't sound like a very mainstream thing to talk about.
Like
having
kids. Lots of sex, but also the very Catholic thing comes with that. Kids, we're not shying away from that. That is part of our future.
Right. The Catholicism, the Christianity, that his upbringing has not completely abandoned him.
Mm-hmm.
Even though he's on his own, he's making mistakes, and he does...
In his most prodigal state.
Yeah, he is, and that's a good comparison, is to the prodigal son. He's on his own. He has no father figure, he has no father Lantham, nobody. He's learning on his own. He's not doing good things. In the comics, I'm not sure about the show, but in the comics, they steal a car.
Mm.
And in this, they broke into somebody's house and they're eating their food and they're doing all kinds of stuff. And it just leads to worse things after that. And he has to sever the relationship. And he's like, she's bringing out the worst in me.
Yeah.
But even still in that prodigal state, he's still thinking like a Catholic.
Mm-hmm.
He's still saying, yeah, we're going to have a lot of sex.
Yeah.
But we're also going to be married. We're going to have a family together.
Mm-hmm.
We're going to have little Matt Jr. and
little Ellie.
Little Ellie. So it's... But, it's... Even though he sleeps with her, you got to remember, he's like 20s.
Mm-hmm.
He doesn't have those influences. He's an orphan. She's a bad influence on him.
Mm-hmm.
And he's still thinking like a Catholic.
Mm-hmm.
Which is an important part of who he is overall as a character.
Well, and we see how he grows from that. When that, he just meets her, he realizes they fit together pretty well, and he sleeps with her. We see later on, I'm sure you got pictures and stuff for it, but I don't know if I'm jumping the gun, but when he's with Karen, he's been with her for a little while. They at least have known each other for a while.
Mm-hmm.
And now she's asking him if she...
Yeah, let's show that.
Oh, you have the clip. Okay.
Yeah, let's compare the Elektra and / She-Hulk relationships, which I think both are toxic in different ways,
mm-hmm.
and compare it with Karen Page, who is a character who, in my opinion, is the love of his life. She's the MJ to Spider-Man for
mm-hmm.
him, or Lois Lane, Superman.
Yeah.
And it took a season and 3 episodes before he made a move on Karen, honestly.
Mm-hmm.
I wanted to show that clip here.
The first kiss one?
Yes.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah. But observe how tender he is with her, and the music, and how gentlemanly he's been up to this point.
He hasn't lost any of the desire that he had with Elektra, but he's gained more respect for himself. He has stronger standards in what he will do, what he is willing to do, and he has more respect for her, honestly.
Yeah, it's a moment that is both sensual but respectful.
Mm-hmm.
It is tastefully done, as Jed always puts out this idea that sexuality doesn't have to be graphic or gross
mm-hmm.
or a one-night stand. It can be a beautiful but also wholesome and tastefully done.
So many of our modern stories have either gone to one of two extremes. Either it's, I don't need love, I'm going to win, I'm going to discover who I am. Or, the love, with Frozen, it's not the love of, true love's kiss between a man and a woman, it's the love of sisters. Not to say that that's a bad thing, but it portrays that as, that this is the highest goal.
Right.
But then you contrast that with the other extreme of just like, yeah, we're gonna have sex, look how awesome it is, oh yeah, we're going for it. There's
yeah.
none of that, oh yeah, there's still this desire between man and woman, but let's present it in not quite a wholesome way, but like a mature way. Not like mature, we're showing nudity, but mature, okay, let's show healthy amounts of desire and love, which go hand in hand between two people, and see how that leads them to act.
Yeah, contrast that with any scene where they have chemistry
mm-hmm.
with She-Hulk, and it's mostly him trying to give her advice for to be a gentleman and her just being thirsty for him.
Yeah.
And it's not respectful. Consider these two lines, which I despise, which are, this guy's kind of doing it for me right now, and, oh yeah, She-Hulk smash things, and occasionally Matt Murdock. It's like, she doesn't respect the man.
Mm-hmm.
And she literally conjures the man out of the aether so that he can be her sex toy.
Yeah.
Her little buddy. And it's like...
I'm surprised you didn't mention what her friend said. Like, oh yeah, well, they saw a guy doing the walking
shame. Let's get that over with. It's not funny when women do it. It's certainly not funny when men do it.
Yeah. So
hands down. It's not a funny joke.
It's
period.
We're not trying to say this double standard of like, oh man, Tony Stark, wasn't he great? No, they show him being
mm-hmm.
a man whore at the beginning of Iron Man to contrast that with the better person he will become.
And that's why I despise the opening of Iron Man 2, is because it felt like he regressed
yeah.
to that person. I was like, I didn't like you in the beginning of the
mm-hmm.
film. I hated you.
Like,
and I had problems growing up with Iron Man.
If you were to
judge a jerk.
Like, if you were to show Captain America at the end of Avengers Endgame deciding to go back and stay with Peggy, and then he looks at the camera and says, a man has his needs, that would have ruined that moment completely. But just showing it rather than saying it, we understand that there was lust involved, but we also understand the love. We understand, him going back to where he belongs and not being a man out of time. There's so much that worked in that moment. And just saying, oh yeah, Hayley Atwell's hot, it ruined so much of that.
You've removed any sort of wholesome
mm-hmm.
or... And let's be frank, it's supposed to be family-friendly.
Yeah.
The MCU's mostly supposed to be family-friendly, and
mm-hmm.
when you have a joke about Steve Rogers, using the F-word as a reference,
mm-hmm.
it's like, that's not funny, and I will roast you all day long for that.
Mm-hmm.
That's not a funny joke either.
Yeah.
But this, she acts like a man, like the grossest of men who objectify Steve Rogers and Daredevil.
Yeah.
She doesn't care about them. She doesn't
mm-hmm.
care about their ambitions, their wants, or whatever.
Yeah, I'm like, not to... I'll explain what I mean by this in a second, but to be brief, she acts like the worst of feminists. Because feminism, I completely get behind. I would consider myself a feminist in that women deserve to be treated under the law exactly the same as men. Any sort of you know, or not even just under the eyes of the law, but just in general, treat women like people. They're people. They're not things. Treat them as such.
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, and
but so many feminists say men are bad. We should be equal to them. So let's be bad as the worst of men.
Yeah.
She is acting like
the
worst men.
Part of the problem rather than part of the solution.
Yes.
Well, it used to be that, in some civilizations, women were considered to be, you're supposed to treat them with even more respect than you treat men. And I think that's still true. If you go to a workforce, any construction site full of guys, you put a girl in there, everyone's going to act a little different. At least
they're going to be on their best behavior.
Yeah. I mean, depending on the girl, if it's like,
regardless of whether they're single or not, if you know it's a sister, a stranger, even someone you don't like.
Yeah, you're going to act a little differently. That's at least in my own experience.
I think we all can agree.
So not necessarily that women should be treated exactly the same. I kind of like that extra respect people just have for them automatically.
Right. Because you're going to err on one side, err on the side of treating them better.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. And Daredevil tries to do that by taking her to dinner. And they make this inconsistent mistake by saying, oh, he'll reciprocate and he'll sleep with her because he does that in the comics. It's bad in the comics. Doesn't make sense with the strong Catholicism.
It goes
it
back
to makes sense in the show.
Goes
yeah.
back to this.
Yeah, just because something is stupid in the comics doesn't mean that it should be adapted.
It is a funny picture.
Yeah.
It is because that's the defense.
It's so incongruous
it's
with
like,
who we know Matlock to be.
Yeah. So let's see.
Yeah.
Let's go into the religious side. Huh?
Okay. Yeah. We'll go into the religious side. Get this out of the way. I think I'm the only one who's seen Miss Marvel here, right?
I think
yeah.
so. Yeah. I've heard good things.
I didn't love the middle of it, but I did like the middle of it. Overall, I found it to be delightful. And one of the things I was most surprised by is by how open they were with the depiction of Islam. You want to go ahead and pull that up? Like they show her and her friend, you know, a very realistic depiction of what it's like to go to mosque, their different headdresses, the fact that they're separated from the man and why that is, you know, even things that I may not love myself about Islam, they show like, hey, this is important to them, so we will take it seriously.
Isn't it a point in the show that she has a costume that's modest?
Yes,
yeah.
Absolutely.
And
because she loves superheroes, and even, you know, her favorite, Captain Marvel, tends to dress fairly modestly,
yeah.
But her mother, you know, this is something that's very important to them. You know, we don't like how so many superheroes is like, this is over-sexualized, this is not good for you, Kamala. Not because superheroes are, because this aspect, we don't want you to get too sucked up into that. So when she becomes a superhero, her family knows, and so her mother and many of her mother's friends who also know, we are going to make you a superhero suit that you can be proud of. But it also is modest and is all the things that we care about. And it's a great costume. It's the only Marvel costume that's a dress, and it's fun to look at the different challenges of that.
Yeah.
It's unique while also drawing inspiration from others, both other superheroes, being Captain Marvel, and her own culture and religion. I loved that.
Yeah.
And even with, you know, Moon Knight, which we'll go into here, Moon Knight, his religion, his being a Jew, wasn't a big part of the show like it was in Miss Marvel, but it wasn't hidden away either. When they go to his mom's funeral, everyone is in traditional Jewish, you know, they're mourning. They have their kippahs on. They're not trying to hide this. This is who they are. This is part of their identity. Their culture is important.
One of his personalities is married. He's
yeah.
not just with this woman. He's married to this woman.
Yeah, and that's the thing that drove me insane. And I added this in the comment section because people were saying, why are you bringing up religion with Daredevil? I said, and comparing it to these other characters, and I said, because he's a religious person.
Mm-hmm.
And why is it that
I don't bring up religion with Tony Stark. I don't bring up religion with Thor.
But I do with
Thor.
Well, yeah, you bring it up with people who are religious because that's important to the viewers. If it's if it's okay that it's important to Muslims that Miss Marvel represent.
Yes.
Or to Moon Knight fans that he represent. It's just as okay for me to say Matt Murdock is a Christian and he should conduct himself as such.
Yeah.
If she can have a standard of modesty and he can be married, he can say to She-Hulk, you know what? I've done the whole one-night stand thing before. I'm a Catholic. I'm pushing 40 and so are you.
Yeah.
How about we act our age
mm-hmm.
and let's be respectful to each other instead of just having this lousy one-night stand?
Yeah. it's important to us because we're not Catholic, but it's important to us that he be Catholic because it's important to him.
Yeah.
His very first scene in the Marvel Netflix show, you know, first scene of Matt Murdock as an adult, at least, is him in confession. He's telling us so much about the hate in his heart, this desire for violence, but his higher desire to be better than that.
It's a result of his relationship with Elektra because she almost got him to beat a man to death.
Mm-hmm.
And he's like, he's coming close every night to doing that again, but he needs something that keeps him grounded, and it is the morality found within his faith that keeps him grounded, and it's an important part. And it's an important part not only because of that, but because it's an important part of his family. His dad was a Catholic. His mom was a Catholic. His mom, go ahead and transition this one up. His mom is, he's so Catholic, his mom's a nun.
Now, granted, he doesn't know that, but she does basically raise him.
Yeah, and she raises him in the orphanage, and he doesn't realize that's his mother the whole time. But he's so Catholic, his mom's a nun. Like, you can't get much more Catholic than that unless his dad turned out to be a priest.
Well, and he speaks at the funeral. That's a funeral, right?
Yeah, he speaks at the funeral of a priest. You know, go ahead and pull that up. He does a great job of pulling from Catholic theology. He understands it. He lives it. Like any Catholic or like any person, he fails to live it perfectly. And that guilt weighs on him. But it means so much to him. It's not shame, not the sense of, I'm bad, I can't be forgiven. It's, I can't believe I did this. I'm better than this. I need to be better than this. Let me do this.
Yeah, and we're not asking them to put, like, big symbolic themes like Zack Snyder, you know, with Superman being Jesus and all that.
Mm-hmm. Although sometimes they are heavy-handed with religious influence.
They do in the... Yeah, pull that picture up.
Mm-hmm.
They do in its own show, but when he's cameoing in the She-Hulk show, you don't need to
It doesn't have to be dripping with, oh, this is the Pieta, there is the cross.
Yeah, they can just show how he would act as a Catholic man that's in his 40s. If he was, like, Daredevil 18-year-old and he hooks up with She-Hulk, maybe that's okay. But this is a mature Daredevil.
Mm-hmm.
We have seen him do this. We already know not who he is.
He's evidently still single, so this is a man pushing 40 who, you know, he's clearly not cheating on anyone. Otherwise, man, they would have really screwed up the character.
Fornication is still a sin
in
all three of those religions we talked about.
Yeah, this is somebody who's saying, look, at this point in my life, I'm still single. I want a family. I want to be married. I want to have kids. But one night stand will not lead me to that at 40.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's just bad.
And whatever happened to Karen Page, if it is canon, it's like all
that's
that good
review.
It's like it's not going to be worth it. And there's another good point that somebody, I want to give a shout out to Jamillion 8, who made a video called Daredevil Ruined Again, and he said there's a distinction that must be made with Matt Murdock as a character.
Mm-hmm.
He is a ladies' man, not a womanizer.
Mm-hmm.
And I thought that was brilliantly said. A womanizer is someone like Tony Stark or occasionally Batman. He wants to get into the pants of other women. He wants to take them to bed. A playboy. A ladies' man is somebody who women are comfortable around. They are...
They're attracted to him physically, but they're also attracted to, like, the brooding, guilty part. But the self-control. But he's also understanding. He's empathetic, compassionate.
He's somebody women want to be around and is friends with a lot of women.
Mm-hmm.
And that's
someone women want to be around and be with.
They feel
they're
safe.
Different things, but they go together with him.
And, you know, he's always conducted himself up to this point, this version of the character. Yeah, exactly. First it was Claire. And even the very first episode, the realtor, you know, he's respectful to her. He doesn't take her to bed.
Mm-hmm.
He doesn't take Claire to bed. You know, it takes like 3 or 4 episodes before they have a kiss, and then it doesn't go anywhere because they're both mature adults who realize that they're not compatible with his lifestyle.
And even when Elektra comes back in the show in the present, she's still like, hey, want to pick things up where we left off? And he has grown as a person to say no. And even throughout the season, even while it may be the weakest season, one of the stronger elements for me is watching how he does want to slip back into those old ways, but he is strong enough to hold strong, and that attraction still being there, because, you know, ordinarily they pull towards each other, he's not moving, so he's pulling her towards him. Their relationship is making her a better person, even though they're not actually in a relationship.
Right. And
so if you want to show She-Hulk as being someone who is a little more, you know, physical and all that, you can still do that while having him be the one who say,
I'm on, at a higher standard.
Yeah,
if you
that's not who
me,
I am.
You need to...
You need to come up to my level.
Right. Yeah, well, my theory for She-Hulk is none of it's canon, because at the end,
She breaks canon.
She breaks the canon.
It's meta, I get it.
It's all...
She's done that in the comics.
It's all that she... it's all in her head. She tells the studio what she wants to happen, and it happens. But to me, it's just like, nah, none of this actually happened.
Yeah, what was it? I saw a video
like,
once.
Or if it did happen, it didn't happen like that.
Yeah, she can't make Matt Murdock teleport to her whenever she wants.
Yeah, that's...
Literally
just,
drops out of the
yeah,
sky.
She's
yeah,
insane. It's just... Yeah, I hope She-Hulk stays in her own little TV series, and we just move on from this.
Mm.
Don't put her in Avengers. She's just going to be obnoxious. I'd rather have Daredevil break the fourth wall than She-Hulk.
I think it was a video you were watching, Jed, where the guy mentioned, he's like, when she breaks the fourth wall, they do it so much to the point where it gets annoying.
Mm.
Yeah.
Whereas you get Deadpool or...
Deadpool
like,
sometimes is pushing.
Or
Ferris Bueller.
Or Ferris Bueller.
Yeah.
Like, those, they do a good job at breaking the fourth wall in a... not annoying way.
Yes.
Like, first Bueller, then credits. What are you guys still doing here? Or I guess it's Deadpool.
Yeah,
what are you guys
right?
doing? They do it in a funny way. With, for her, she does it so often in a very, like, wink at the camera, like, ha ha, you
it's
got
like,
it.
Yeah, yeah, we get it.
Yeah.
So, and,
it's not
just going off the line of who he is and how he's matured in his 30s, could we pull up the clip of Matt and Karen? This discussion, this is after their first official date. They've known each other for...
Don't wear this one, right?
Yeah.
Yep. They've okay. known each other for a while, and things get steamy at the doorstep. So go ahead.
Hey, come on.
Yes. Second.
First date.
Second kiss. First date.
I would love to. But you...
If for anyone who's questioning the light flash, it's... copyrighted.
It's okay, guy. Can I tell you why? Because I have this incredible ability to bring disaster to the best things in my life, and tonight has been perfect.
So if you had trouble hearing that,
it's a fairly intimate scene where they're whispering.
Yeah.
Oh, I forgot they were whispering. That's my bad.
You're good. Essentially, she's saying, hey, do you want to go upstairs? Because Karen, technically, she's not religious. She says her parents are, and that's
mm-hmm.
all we know about her religious upbringing. But he says, I'd like to. And she says, but you won't. And he's like, you know me, you know.
Mm-hmm.
I am a good Catholic boy.
I tend to ruin things that are good. This is already good, so let's leave it here. We'll see where it goes in the future.
He's learned that the commandments of God, which apply to the three religions we had talked about, apply, and that there is, when you have those intimate relations, it can be ruined, and you can have a really, really hard falling out, and he doesn't want to ruin that with her, because he's a gentleman, and also because he's had bad experience as well. And it was important to me to show that, and I want to give a shout out to Anomaly Incorporated. In his video, they ruined him, referring to Daredevil. He brought up that clip as well. And it's important to show that because Catholics who, or any Christian or any religious person who is devout, is not going to be quick to jump into bed with somebody they've known for an evening.
Mm-hmm.
And that's why I think we all have a problem with his relationship with She-Hulk, especially
mm-hmm.
since they're both pushing 40
yeah.
and acting so immature.
Not the idea of it in general, but how it was depicted and handled within She-Hulk.
Mm-hmm. So, and it's not something any of us... here are a fan of.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, there's a lot of defenses of this, that he's, it's a different show, he's funny in this show, he's great, it's different.
Yeah, it's
yeah.
bad.
Yeah, it's
I don't mind them
yeah,
saying, hey,
get
we,
the difference.
We
it's
can,
bad.
We can lean into, you know, being a little more lighthearted, we can lean into a little more of the pulpy adventure comic stuff, rather than being so overwhelmingly dark and brooding. But for one, it was such a huge departure with how far they took it. And two, even if you are going to take it that far, you didn't execute it well.
Yeah. Well, and yeah. It's basically the same thing I have with Kingpin. If they didn't have all the blowing up and stuff and kept him small cameo,
mm.
it would have been fine. And if they didn't, if they had her take him seriously as a human being and as a person,
mm-hmm.
instead, because she's such a narcissist, him showing an interest in her automatically makes her want to jump in the bed with him.
Mm-hmm.
But if he sort of put his foot down and said, no, I'm a strong religious person, and...
Just like that.
Well, basically, just like that, yeah. I'm a strong religious person, and
well, he
and you are not living your life responsibly, which is
mm-hmm.
supposed to be the theme of the show.
You know,
at the very beginning, in her opening speech, she talks about responsibility and accountability. And he's like, you have this power, you have this opportunity to be on both sides of the law,
yeah.
mm-hmm.
and all those things, and to have that speech. And I thought he was going to be a mentor to her in the same vein as Stick was a mentor to him,
mm-hmm.
but albeit in a positive
way. Like, I will
way.
Teach you how to balance your life well.
Yeah, and instead it's the result of that speech is, oh, this guy's really doing it for me because he's talking about me, and I, myself, and it's like, can you just listen to him for 5 minutes and be a hero?
Keep your pants on.
Keep your pants on for 5 seconds, you know? It's like, take the speech seriously, you know?
Mm-hmm.
Hulk gave her essentially the same speech, but because it's Daredevil now, she just lusts after him. And it's
mm-hmm.
like, this is stupid.
Yeah.
Can we take anything seriously for 5 seconds? No, we can't. That's...
Nope.
Hate.
Yeah. It should have been more like how the Peter Parkers were in No Way Home.
Yeah.
Just let me those guys...
Pass my experience to you so you don't have to suffer to learn the same lessons.
Yeah. And then she could idolize him and everything. And
yeah,
maybe
sure.
she could... want to do it, but then
he's
could
an
teach her
guy, they had chemistry, sure.
Then he could teach her, I've had relationships in the past that, you know, with superheroes or whatever. He
mm-hmm.
could allude to Elektra or whatever.
Yeah.
But he's like, at the end of the day, I have a girl back home and she's waiting for me and you're not
mm-hmm.
her, you know.
But there
but
there's
they
a guy
they
out
just,
there for you.
They could have done
yeah.
whole Tobey Maguire, like, oh, I MJ and I, we're, it's working out. They could have alluded to Karen.
Right.
But they didn't. They just totally ignore her. She's not part of the story anymore. Daredevil's 40 years old, and he's still a single loser. And he just sleeps with the Green Giant on occasion.
The Jolly Green Giant.
Yeah.
No, that's actually well put. I like that.
Do you want to close out by talking about... what we hope to see briefly
yes.
in Daredevil Born Again.
So this is here's my outcomes for this. A, that he's a Skrull. None of this means anything. B,
his depiction in She-Hulk is a Skrull.
Yes, specifically that, because why else would he wear that suit?
Mm.
Except for my explanation said earlier. B, Bryn said it's very loose canonically speaking, so
mm-hmm.
maybe I can ignore it. I doubt there'll be a second season. That could still happen. Doubt it. And then option three is I become in charge of Daredevil and everything I say is canon, and I say that is not canon. So, and then because the good there is good news with the Born Again.
Yeah.
There's been clips of him working with an actual mixed martial artist.
Mm-hmm.
Like he really wants to nail this.
Yes.
And then we have the stunt choreographer talking about how he had ideas for season four that are just going to blow the mind, but then it was cut.
Yeah.
But he's like, now I can go back and do those things. So
mm-hmm.
the action sounds like it will still be
yes.
on par, albeit more less gory and more Dark Knight, the Batman
mm-hmm.
sort of thing, which
yeah.
is what I wanted in the first place. But
mm-hmm.
why did you put a turd in between of the sandwich of glory with
yeah.
him and Spider-Man and then Born Again and all these wonderful announcements?
Well, I think they got the whoever, I don't know who was in charge of the She-Hulk. I don't care, but whoever they got, they didn't. I don't think they really like She-Hulk as a character, because I've seen people complain about how she's not really like the comics. She's a horrible lawyer.
Yeah, she's supposed
and,
to be a better lawyer than him in the comics.
Yeah,
yeah.
And so they don't like She-Hulk, or they don't understand her, and then they don't like Daredevil, especially
mm-hmm.
Netflix Daredevil. They don't give a crap about that. You know, it's the same thing what I argue with Star Wars projects, Lord
mm-hmm.
of the Rings projects, whatever it is. If you don't respect what came before... especially if you're using the same actor
right.
and alluding to, oh yeah, they're going to like this because it's associated with
mm-hmm.
that. I mean, look at The Hobbit. They couldn't do that because they had five studios, and five studios wanted
mm-hmm.
them to do different things, but
yeah.
wouldn't respect the source material
mm-hmm.
or the movies that came before. And that's what happened to this show. It's just they got people who don't
yeah.
care or don't respect what came
mm-hmm.
before. And
or just don't understand it.
Or don't understand it.
Mm-hmm. See, like... if I were to compare this, you know, this depiction of Daredevil and She-Hulk to Luke in The Last Jedi, With that one, they say, hey, it's been 30 years. He's not the same character. And for some people, it worked, and for some people, it didn't. And for the people it didn't, their problem isn't just that he's not the same character. It's, okay, you made him into this new character. We didn't get to go on a journey with him to see him become this new character.
Right.
And so you could fix it by telling that story. It may be a hard pill to swallow for some, but it's possible. But with Daredevil, they're straight up saying, you know, functionally, this is the same character. Whether it's not, you know, whether he went on these adventures, accept him as the same person.
Yeah.
And it's hard to bring us on a journey to show him become this new person if he already is, quote unquote, this same person.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. It's like how in,
agreed.
It's like how in, Cobra Kai.
Mm.
I'm a big fan of Cobra Kai.
Mm-hmm.
This last season, last couple seasons, the main bad guy is Terry Silver. And that's from the worst Karate Kid movie, other than the next Karate Kid.
Yeah.
But he's from the worst Karate Kid movie, but they made him a really compelling, interesting villain that seems, in some ways, the most dangerous.
Mm-hmm.
And it's just like, had they ignored the third Karate Kid movie, we would never have gotten Terry Silver back.
Mm-hmm.
And that's why I think if they do the Jon Snow show, they can't just ignore that Tyrion fell in love
with Daenerys.
That,
yeah.
You can't ignore that. You gotta just accept it and move on. You can say he was love-stricken or whatever, but you got to accept it and move on.
Yeah.
You can't just take something. And that's why people like Dave Filoni should be working on The Clone Wars, because he actually respected it, even though back then nobody liked it.
Yeah.
He's like, oh, I understand what he was going for. And that's why you get people that respect what came before. And they make things. And then you get Daredevil, and it's just so obvious. They didn't care.
So moving forward into Daredevil Born Again, I hope they at least acknowledge that something happened on the West Coast with She-Hulk and all that. But
it's inconsequential.
Yes, it's inconsequential at best, and at worst, he made mistakes. Not like, you know, oh, this destroys who I am, but like, okay, you know, if he's in a relationship, then he needs to come clean. But if he's not, it's just, okay, this is the West Coast, I was going out there, okay, I screwed up, I need to recommit to who I am.
Yeah, and what they could do is they could do the multiverse, bring in Netflix Daredevil, and have him kick his butt.
Yeah, that'd be hilarious.
Are you not Catholic?
The thing is, he's,
what's a Catholic?
His next appearance isn't Born Again, it's actually Echo.
Oh, that's true.
So I'm wondering, because Echo does have a relationship with him in the comics, I'm like, why are you jumping with him and She-Hulk? Like, you have a deaf... I don't know how they communicate, but you have a deaf person and a blind person who have a relationship in the comics. And she's cameoing in the show. Why did you make him sleep with She-Hulk? That doesn't make any sense.
How are they going to communicate?
So, and I thought, you know, Echo's okay.
There you go, yeah.
But,
more to go.
The language of love.
Yeah, I thought you, yeah.
No.
So,
no. So, but anyway, that's his next appearance, and what I'm hoping is basically, obviously they focus on Echo. I think she's more interesting than She-Hulk is at this point, more than Captain Marvel, who I'll take over She-Hulk, because I'll take a block of wood over stupid cartoon any day. But I just hope that he's in there with Fisk, and that they have interactions, and that he doesn't have a stupid suit. I hope it's the black one this
time. Yeah.
If you're going to go with a different suit.
Oh, that'd be sweet.
The black one's cool. And put the DD on his chest.
Well, yeah, and the thing with the whole not ignoring the whole, like, season 8 of Game of Thrones and Karate Kid 3 is what came before that was really, really good. This Daredevil has nothing before it that builds off it, because the Netflix isn't canon. We all know. So all they have right now is She-Hulk Daredevil.
Yeah, the Netflix show isn't something you have to stick to, but it shows us the potential of what you could give us. Yeah.
Yes, but at the same time, I don't trust that they can save this. Because to me, Disney Daredevil is just the She-Hulk. Netflix is its own thing.
That's where it's at.
Yeah. That's where it's at. I don't think they can get there again. I don't trust Disney, at least with Daredevil. But we'll see. If they manage to pull it off and make him cool again, I'll be really, really impressed and happy.
Yes.
So,
we want to close out with this this monologue from the show.
And
this is something that shows his conflict, his anger, his moral code, his moral strength.
And I take it as, and I wish it was a meme, but pretend that we have the word on Daredevil's face saying, Daredevil as who he really is, and then Fisk is Disney. So, go ahead.
You want me to kill you? No prison can keep me. You know that. Come on! Kill me!
No!
God knows I want you, but you don't get to destroy who I am! You will go back to prison, and you will live the rest of your miserable life in a cage, knowing you'll never have Vanessa, that this city rejected you. It beat you! I beat you!
So, this character is important to us, you know, especially, and there's a lot of characters you can relate with that don't have to look like you. You know, my favorite character in the Justice League for a long time was Jon Stewart. Doesn't look like me at all. It doesn't matter.
You're watching.
Yeah. Well, that's
Jon Green Lantern.
Oh.
Yeah, this is the Black Green Lantern. But on a religious side, that moment specifically when he says, God knows I want to. But you do not get to destroy who I am. You know, that's every religious person, regardless of the religion, the three monotheistic
Abrahamic religions, yeah.
Yeah. That's what they want to be able to say at the end of the day to the devil. And that's what he is essentially saying to his own personal devil. You don't get to destroy who I am. And
yeah.
I wish he said that to She-Hulk. Maybe I do want to go to bed with you, but...
She's an attractive woman, sure.
But you don't get to destroy who I am.
Mm-hmm.
And that's the crux of this whole thing for me is, you know, you don't get to destroy who he is just because you see the world differently than him. Try looking at things from his point of view. That's why Captain America was well done in the first Avengers.
Mm-hmm.
Joss Whedon in the commentary said, I'm an atheist. But Steve Rogers is a Christian, straight up. And I'm going to respect that. Even though I don't agree with him, he's going to say, yeah, there's only one God. And he doesn't dress like that. And at the end of the day, Daredevil, same story. He's a
probably even
person.
Stronger in his religious convictions.
I would say so. And, you know, as far as attending and all that,
yeah.
Being knowledgeable, whereas Steve, his morality is drawn from the religion.
Mm-hmm.
And that's why we like him so much. And that's why taking that away from either of those two characters... who, by the way, are my two favorite characters in all of Marvel, is Captain America and Daredevil, the first two, because they have conviction, they have religion, but they can also be fierce warriors, and they can defend truth, justice, the American way, whatever you want to say. They can do those things while still being kind and compassionate. Best Daredevil comic I ever read, Daredevil Born Again, when he embraces Karen Page. You should read the comic, but when he embraces...
Somebody who ruined his life at that point.
Right, in this version of the story. Karen Page has ruined his life. He's lost everything.
But she's now contrite.
And when he sees her in the state where she's lost everything too, and he's in this position to help her, he does. He embraces her, and the comparisons to Jesus Christ in that imagery, in the Catholicism... in Christianity, in the imagery, beautiful, most emotionally satisfying comic I've ever read. And when you remove that from Daredevil, I don't want to take him seriously, and I don't want to participate in that anymore, which is why I despise comics that take that away from him.
Daredevil is not an actor. You can't just grab an actor and say, oh, this is Daredevil, everything you know about him. He embodies it. It's like, the script also does matter.
Yeah.
You can take Batman. Batman can be anyone, but if he's... He has to be dark, you know.
He doesn't have that desire for vengeance, but that strong moral code of, I will not become the person who made me into this.
And also has very high compassion for children who go through things that are traumatic like he has.
Mm-hmm.
Like the kid in the Justice League cartoon that's got the powers to delete everything in existence or whatever.
Mm-hmm.
Like he has the option to kill this kid so that...
Rose the wrist.
So that the kid doesn't kill everyone, but instead he decides to sit by the kid on the swing and
spend the last moment.
Yeah. You know, and stuff like that just really, really puts these heroes on another level.
Mm-hmm.
It's not the flashy images. It's not always the fight scenes.
Yeah. We hold these people as heroes, as people to emulate, not because, look at that, they beat up the bad person,
mm-hmm.
but because of why they beat up the bad person, what they are fighting for.
Yeah. You can't bait and switch us just because you got the actor.
Mm-hmm.
That's not Daredevil to me. I'm sorry. Marvel, the actor, that doesn't mean anything. I don't care if he's excited to be back. So far, he's not Daredevil to me. Actors can mess up and choose stupid projects to work
on. Charlie Cox, he gave it his all in this role. Our problem is not with his performance.
Yeah.
No.
No, yeah. Charlie Cox, still a good actor and all that, but it's not Daredevil.
Yeah. And
Kingpin's more Kingpin than Daredevil's Daredevil, huh?
In a sense.
Well, the problem with Kingpin is they build him up to be all scary and stuff, but then the only times you see him, he gets beat.
That's true.
But
he still feels more like Kingpin than Daredevil.
Yeah, yeah.
Well, he's more like Kingpin, even if that's not paid off. Mm-hmm. Well, it has been a very good discussion today. Really fun to talk about this. You know, a lot of people want to portray any critiques of this version as just being angry or just for the sake of it. It's not for the sake of it. We actually care.
Mm-hmm.
And we have an opinion that's different than yours. So please be respectful of that.
And if you disagree with us, let's talk about it in the comments. I'd love to discuss it with somebody.
I'd love to prove you wrong.
You heard it, folks.
Yeah. But thank you for joining us today. It's been helpful. It's been therapeutic. I've been in a lot of pain on this issue just as a
physical
aside thing.
Mm-hmm.
It's been good to just talk about it and have like-minded people and to avoid toxicity on either side. So, Robert, where can they find us?
You can find us on Twitter @ofcinematics and here on YouTube. And if you can't watch the video, you can also hear us on anchor.fm and Spotify and a few other podcast places. Yeah. So you can subscribe here on this channel, and you can also subscribe $4.99 a month on Anchor. That'll help us get more equipment, like better mics, and maybe sponsors. Who knows? And we'll see you next time.
See you later. Something.